Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord. And as we gather today, let us sing with all our hearts and let us prepare our hearts for our worship and before our God today. And before we start, before we begin, I would like to remind everyone to please sit behind the green stickers. And if you do have your vaccination tags, please have them on display. So at this time, let's prepare our hearts. As we worship and as we gather in one spirit, let us worship Him today with one voice. We sing of His mercies, as we sing of His love that is new, mercy that is new every morning. Let us give thanks to our God, and let us worship Him, and let us sing with one voice together in unison. Let's all rise from our seats. Let's sing as we gather.
And as we gather, may Your Spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify Your name, knowing well that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came.
As we gather.
As we gather, may Your Spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify Your name,
knowing well
that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came. We'll be blessed because we came.
Let's sing as we gather.
As we gather, may Your Spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify Your name,
knowing well
that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came. We'll be blessed because we came.
Sing the steadfast love.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end.
They are new every morning.
They are new every morning. New every morning.
Great is Thy faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness.
Blessing the steadfast love.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end.
They are new.
They are new every morning. New every morning. Great. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is Thy faithfulness. Perfect You are, my God. Righteous and holy in all of Your ways, revealing Your glory in I will worship you. I will worship you. I will praise your name. For you are the only Lord and King. And I will worship you. And I will praise your name. My desire is to honor you, Lord. My desire is to honor you, Lord, and I will worship you, I will praise your name, for you are the only Lord and King. I will worship you, I will praise your name, my desire is to honor you, Lord. All that I am, all that I have, I lay them down before you, O Lord. All my regrets, all my acclaim, my joy and my pain, I'm making them yours.
Let's sing this one more time. All that I am,
all that I am, all that I have, I lay them down before you, O Lord. All my regrets and all my acclaim, the joy and the pain, I'm making them yours.
Lord, I offer
my life to you, everything I've been through. Use it for your glory, Lord. I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice.
Lord, I offer you my life.
Lord, I offer you my life.
Things in the past,
things yet unseen, wishes and dreams that are yet to come true. All of my hopes, all of my plans, my joy and my hands are lifted to you. Lord, I offer, then Lord, I offer my life to you. Everything I've been through, use it for your glory. Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you. As a pleasing sacrifice, Lord, I offer, and Lord, I offer you my, Lord, I offer my life to you, everything I've been through, use it for your glory, Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Lord, I offer you my life.
Lord, we can give you nothing, Lord. All we can give is our life, our lives to you, Lord. Lord, as we sing all that we are, all that we have, let us give all that we are, let us give all that we have to you, Lord. We give ourselves as a living sacrifice unto you, Lord. And as we listen to your word, Father, speak to us. We pray that you would receive our praise today. In Jesus' name we pray.
Would you please remain standing and let us now affirm our faith with the reading of the Apostles' Creed in unison. Begin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know
Thank you for that beautiful song. Our Lord searches our hearts and knows our hearts through and through. So this morning, let us open up our hearts to the Word as we pay attention to the Word of God. I will read for you. Our scripture this morning comes to us from the Old Testament, the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 33. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 33. And I will read the word of God for you. The Lord's curse is on the house of the wicked, but he blesses the home of the righteous. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Your Heavenly Father, we come before your word once more to pay attention to where your heart is. Oftentimes we pursue after the blessings that you give without thinking about your righteousness and how you've called us to be holy and righteous. Please teach us and strengthen us with your word this morning so that we may focus on your holiness becoming ours first and foremost always. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. The light is what guides you home. The warmth is what keeps you there. Now, I read this quote this week and thought, that's right. You know, nothing's better than going home and eating good food at home and, you know, relaxing at home. And if you live with your family members, you know, sharing those blessed moments with them, right? Even if this is not so, we all have an ideal of what a good home should look like. It's a place where we find comfort and where we find rest. But today I would like to, you know, emphasize another dimension of home that we can often overlook. I also came across this quote by Walt Disney. He once said, "You can design and create and build the most wonderful place in the world, but it takes people to make the dream a reality." And you know, this was great insight for me. I believe here he is implying that it's not a matter of where you live, which neighborhood you're in, or how big or beautiful your house is. It's really about who is living in it. It's the person or the people that you live with or work with that really matter, that really set the atmosphere, that really, you know, change things. But oftentimes when we say the word home, we refer to a place such as a house or an apartment where a person lives, right? The dictionary, too, defines a home as a place, a space, a building, an architectural structure that accommodates human beings or a human being. And in the world, this home changes according to your financial status, right? The more money you are able to earn, the more pleasant things become, the better your home condition gets. If you live in a good neighborhood and in a nice house, you know, your friends might come over for a barbecue and tell you, you know, what a nice home you have. If your friend is a Christian, he or she might add, God has blessed you with so much. And you know, it's so easy to think this way when we are living in this world. But how about bringing in a little change in our perspective? Yes, where you live can influence you. And a blessed home of abundance can provide a good foundation for your life. True, but let's think about this. And this is the first thing I want us to take home today. Point one, God blesses the person in the house, not the house itself. It's really about who's living in it. The worldly perspective will always try to turn our eyes from the person to something else. And we often hear things like, Hey, did you hear there's an exceedingly high-priced plot of land you shouldn't miss? If you get a hold of that piece of land, blessings will roll in the door. Or something like, you got to get into that neighborhood to succeed. Dear brothers and sisters, the biblical perspective tells us otherwise in many cases. God blesses a righteous person in his eyes, and wherever that person goes, that place will become a place of blessing. Whoever that person meets, that relationship will become a blessed relationship. Whatever that person touches, that family, that enterprise, that group, that community, that company will become a blessing, not the other way around. I'm not saying that everything will turn out to be successful. There will be hardships, yes. Temptations, of course, and suffering, even for those that are righteous in God's eyes, of course. But eventually, God will work it out and let you see that it was a blessing in the end. Romans chapter 8, verse 28, New Living Translation, reminds us that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. So it's really about living according to the purpose of God, which is living a righteous life to God's eyes. As long as you are home to God, your actual home is like a bus station that you pass through. This is what our passage today is talking about. Let's take a closer look at this. In our passage, we first see the wicked person who possesses a house. It's a strong and stately dwelling, perhaps, but the curse of the Lord is upon it, is in it, is around it. And though the affairs of the family may seem like they're prospering, yet the very blessings are actually curses. A commentary on this verse added a description like this about this verse, and let me just read it. Quote, "There is leanness in the soul when the body is fed to the full. The curse may work silently and slowly, but it is as a fretting leprosy. It will consume the timber thereof and the stones thereof," unquote. In short, the wicked might tap their bellies and boast about their wealth and their awesome houses, and it may seem like they're blessed by God, but the foundation and the pillars of the house may be on their way to destruction without any warning. Now, a while ago, I had to go see a dermatologist because my foot condition was really bad and my right big toenail dislocated itself from the toe totally. Don't even talk about it. It's a horrible experience. It hurt. I was cutting my toenails like usual, and that's what happened. And the reason for this is important was because I left it as is for a long period of time. I had athlete's foot, and on top of that, I also had eczema blisters all over my feet. Because I've been in dress shoes since my 20s, right? I've been wearing these, you know, dress shoes. It gives a lot of stress to the feet. And whenever the condition seemed to get worse and worse, I kept saying, it'll be all right. A little itch, doesn't matter. I can stand it. It won't kill me. And then I saw the toenail falling off from my foot. To be very honest, your brothers and sisters, I was scared by that. And I was scared by that sight. So I went to the doctor immediately the next day. And the doctor, I showed him my feet. And he looked at me like, oh, man, you poor guy. He said, with pity, how did you live like this? You neglected the problem, this condition, for too long. And it is really bad. It's going to take at least 6 months to cure. And today I'm still on medication, and the healing is in progress. I'm okay. Now, why am I telling you this horrible, shameful foot story on this holy morning? Well, because my negligence of my foot condition is sort of like the wicked saying, I'll be fine when I'm living in this huge house. I'll be fine when I am dwelling in this nice place. Without knowing, things will fall out. Things will slide like this disease that's eating away your skin slowly. The wicked doesn't know what's happening to them. The Bible doesn't stop there, though. In contrast, the righteous, too, has a habitation. It's a poor cottage. The word is used for sheepcotes. It's a very mean, harsh, rough dwelling to live in. But what does it say here? God blesses it, because the righteous is in it. He is continually blessing it from the beginning of the year to the end of it. And I have in mind the life of Joseph in the Bible. His life was righteous to God's eyes. Wherever he went, he depended on God. Though he was moved from one place to another by the worldly forces and the threats of men, though he lived a dynamic life of a migrant facing various hardships, Joseph lived a righteous life, and God used him as a blessing. Insecure circumstances were overcome by his secureness in God. It seemed like there was no next step for him. God always had the next step for him, which was always a part of God's greater plan. Look at what he says in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20 and 21, New Living Translation. You intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so I could save the lives of many people. No, don't be afraid. I will continue to take care of you and your children. So he reassured them by speaking kindly to them. God used Joseph to save the very people who sold him as a slave. Do you see the irony in this? The one who was expelled from a home saves that household. The wicked kneels at the feet of the righteous in the end. And what I was further amazed about is how Joseph kept his cool. His attitude, can you believe this? He could have received them as slaves. They were that desperate. But he doesn't do an eye for an eye here, which was a common thing to do during those times. He doesn't. And this is the second thing to keep in mind today, to take home. Point two, the righteous will keep calm and be kind. We don't stop at being calm. We're actually kind. That's what God is asking the righteous. Your brothers and sisters, Christians are the ones that hold faith to the fact that they are saved by grace through Jesus Christ. Living a righteous life is what follows after this precondition. And for the righteous, there is no room for wickedness. I believe that this morning God is calling us and inviting us into his presence, and he is telling us to check a few things with him. For instance, is there a certain wickedness that has permeated your life? And perhaps you're going, it's going to be all right. I'll think about that later. And your negligence is in exercise. Before praying for blessings upon your life and your household and your assets, pray about the wicked domains that are nibbling away your walls and your pillars. Blessings won't matter if you don't stand up straight as a righteous person of God? Is there anger in your heart? We should check that too. And sometimes you just can't stand others because of the wickedness you see in them. Well, here's a word of advice. Keep calm and be kind to them. Because God is working right now, and he is working through the righteous, which includes you. Our God is a game changer who can shift even the worst situation into a blessing, and he uses the hand of the righteous. Also, is there envy in your heart when you see those who live in big houses, enjoying life in abundance, and you seem less blessed compared to them, and you envy that? Let me reassure you, dear brothers and sisters, a Christian's focus should always be on the person and not his or her possession. We don't envy a person for what they have. We focus on the spirit of a person rather than what surrounds them. We should remember that Jesus had no place to lay his head, but soul after soul, he healed and saved, showing them the way of the righteous. And I pray that we do away with the wicked domains in our lives, the anger and the envy that we may carry in our hearts, and keep our cool and kindness. Now, this week, as part of my meditation on this scripture, I try to recall the happiest moment in my life that I spent with my family at home. I thought of all the homes that we lived in during my childhood until I finally moved out as an adult. The houses or apartments were all different in colors and sizes and shape. Some were in a wealthy neighborhood, yeah, sometimes. Some were in a very rural area, if not underdeveloped. But the interesting thing was, to me, the size of the house or the neighborhood atmosphere didn't set the standard for my happiness or secureness. The happiest moment for me was when our family of four had passion for the Lord, and how we went to church to worship God and pray to God and praise God as a family, although that period didn't last that long. The happiest moment for me was coming back from church and the family still talking about Jesus and how God was working in our family, even though things weren't going that well. The happiest moment for me was when God showed our family precisely and clearly how he's the provider for this family, and we were the firsthand witnesses for his miraculous works. And the happiest moment for me was when we realized that God was still working between the family members, even when the relationships seemed broken and the gap too deep and wide to mend. True light and warmth were there when we were able to make room for our Lord Jesus. You know, Jesus had a home too when he lived here on earth. Nazareth was Jesus' home, a quiet, a very small village southwest of Capernaum. Yes, Jesus was born in Bethlehem, but he grew up in Nazareth. His family lived there, probably had friends there too, so we can surely say that Nazareth was Jesus' hometown. Now, during his public ministry, Jesus had a chance to visit his hometown for one last time. He wanted to give them the best and let them know that he was the Messiah that they were waiting for. He had a message for them. He wanted to heal them. He wanted to love them because Nazareth was his home. Now, people who grew up with Jesus knew that he was a peasant carpenter who had earned his daily bread by the sweat of his brow. And that same man that used to be at the wood shop was now speaking in front of tens and thousands of people with stories of God and wisdom. Now they were amazed, but at the same time they were offended because they expected the extraordinary and spectacular Messiah to be someone else. They could not believe that the Messiah could be a simple, ordinary carpenter who was the son of Mary and the brother of James, Joseph, and Judas, and Simon. In the end, the Bible tells us Jesus could not do any miracles in that place. He was amazed at their lack of faith. And that was the last of it. The people of Nazareth were so consistently unbelieving that they would not even bring their sick to Jesus. Jesus could do nothing. Not because he had limited power, but because no one came forth to receive him in faith. And this leads to our third and last point that I want us to take home. Point three. Making room for Jesus at home may bring you the most precious memory of all, but it may be the hardest task of all. Three action plays, plans for us this week. Let me just summarize it. Number one, focus on each person in the house, not the house itself. Number two, maintain calm and be kind. Number three, make room for Jesus at home. Bring his name into conversation. These are the few secrets to a Christian homemaking, and I pray that they mean something to you. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us this hour, thinking about making our homes a home for you and making our homes a household of God. We bring you wicked hearts, angry hearts, and envying hearts. Please renew them and make us righteous in your eyes as we fill our homes with light and warmth until we meet you at your house, our final destination that you've prepared for us. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Thanks be to God for speaking to us through his word. Would you please join me singing hymn number 612 in response? Hymn number 612. Quite enough power to
And there's quite enough home and quite enough power to chase away any room. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, hid in this very room.
Let us pray. Abba Father, thank you for your tremendous blessing and abundant grace. The life of mortals is like grass, and we flourish like a flower of the field. For you have given us the eternal life, and we are brought into the glory of the children of God. O Jesus, help us to follow in the footsteps of the faith that our father Abraham had. Furthermore, let us love you much more than anyone else, as you did to us during your life ministry in this planet. God of mutual love, thank you for giving us this IUE community, where we can embrace each other and we may walk along the path of life together. May God bless all of us and help IUE to become an open community of friendship in Jesus Christ. There are many subjects of prayer in us. Please hear the voices of each member and fill us with joy of healing and recovery. We pray for Pastor Justin to be strengthened by the Spirit of our Lord Jesus Christ. Please bless his entire family and his message and his ministry. We pray for all the leaders, Elder Shin, deacons, conductor, pianist, organist, soloist, choir members, Nexus praise team, ushers, media team, and all the members who are serving at IUE. Let them glorify your name through their efforts and participation and hospitality. We pray for this nation to be filled with righteousness, peace, and justice. Please use this nation as the instrument of the gospel and help them pursue the kingdom of God rather than human desires. We continue to pray for North Koreans who are suffering from the chains of oppression. Merciful Jesus, let them be recovered from the miserable status and behold the grace of Jesus Christ in crucifixion and resurrection. We pray for those who are struggling with so many problems of feral warfare, natural disaster, starvation. Gracious God, give them strength to overcome them and take the shelter in loving Jesus. Your generosity overflows to us. Everything we have is a gift from you. We now offer back to you a portion of what you have given us. Bless the tithes and offerings we give today. May the offerings that are collected be used for the ministry of this church to bring more souls into your kingdom and to nurture us spiritually. Thank you for hearing our prayers and blessing us. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Like a shepherd, my every need he sees. He leads me by the quiet stream and through the verdant hills. He heals my broken spirit, and when I start to roam, he sets me on a righteous road that brings me safely home. When death becomes my shadow, I need not be afraid. My Lord stay close beside me, his presence gives me aid. And if temptation were He places them my feet. For riches of his toils, what power can compete? His goodness and his mercy may be forever mine, and I will live it in his house through all the lengths of time.
Thank you so much for your wonderful music and devotion. Good morning again. I'd like to welcome each one of you joining us today for IWE Joint Worship Service. If you are here for the first time, would you please raise your hand so that we may recognize you. Let us give a big hand to the newcomers and all of us here today. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Let us connect together after the worship service. YouTube live streaming is available without subtitles during the worship service at the Yongnak IWE YouTube channel. After the service, a YouTube video link of the whole service will be edited and shared in the afternoon around 5 p.m. For those that are fully vaccinated, we recommend to receive a vaccinated tag for easier access. You may stop by the application booth in front of church admin building. You need to bring your ID and COVID certificates through mobile application. For further questions, please let the pastor team know so that you may get additional information and support. You can make offerings to the offertory box at the lobby. Also, there is an online method of giving your offerings for your convenience. Be sure to fill out your name, date of birth, and the offering type. For further information, please refer to the bulletin. General Children's Worship gathers at the admin building 504. Please pray for Pastor Jay and all teachers and students. Let us now recite together the memory verse for this month. Ready? Begin. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to our God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Philippians chapter 6, verses 6 through 7. Amen. Please join the responsive reading of commission and blessing. God respects our complete loyalty and devotion. God's love frees us for joyous living. We will serve the God we have met here. We know that God goes with us everywhere. May worship continue wherever we go. May our service extend God's love to all we meet. We will consult God in our daily choices. We will respond to others in the spirit of Christ. God is faithful in covenant with us. The counsel of God is always available to us. We will take time to rest in God's promises. We will listen for God's word of hope. Amen. Would you please stand and join me in closing song hymn number 415. Hymn number 415. Thank you.
people, showing why our lives is great. One in heart and one in spirit, sign of hope for all the way. Let us show how He has changed us and remade us as His own. Let us share our life together as we share all around His throne. We are called to be God's servants, walking in His world today, taking His own task upon us, all His sacred words obey. Let us ride to His summons, dedicate to Him our all, that we may be faithful servants, quick to answer now His call. We are called to be God's prophet, speaking for the truth and right, standing firm for God's justice, bringing evil into light. Let us seek the courage needed, our high calling to fulfill, that the world may know the blessing of the doing of God's will.
Time for sharing peace with each other. Let me borrow from an old country song. Let us greet each other by saying, "Take me home, Jesus Road. Take me home, Jesus Road." And here is the benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of us that are determined to focus on the dweller rather than the dwelling, maintaining the kindness and boldness that Jesus showed us. As we go out to the world, making room for Jesus in our own homes and in our conversations, from now until forever, amen.